yet, unfortunately, but spreading more than ever before. And so we have an optimism in Asia about development, whereas in Europe and America, there's a huge pessimism. There's a deep pessimism that actually people don't feel like they've benefited from the period of globalization of the last couple of decades. So I think there are lots of lessons there to learn about how to manage it, how to look at each nation's needs, and then to pragmatically apply those lessons to how we go forward.
That's perfect. You have described all the positive aspects of globalization and trade, because trade means poverty reduction. Trade means integration in the regional value chain or global value chain. So it will bring some prosperity for the mass people of the region. But look, only European Union, they have established the all other steps further. Customs union, common market, and a unique currency, common currency. So everything has been established in only EU. NAFTA, the North American region, they tried it. South Asia, the SAC, through SAFTA, we tried it. In Africa, African Free Trade Agreement, they also trying. ASEAN countries, as you mentioned rightly pointed out, that ASEAN countries are the second largest beneficiary of globalization, because after EU, the ASEAN is the another successful model. Currently, they also included 5 global power: China, Japan, South Korea, Australia, and New Zealand in RCEP, as a form of RCEP. So this is the second successful story. But till now, sir, I have some doubt. There are some, as you were mentioning, that in the West, a pessimist concept is growing. In the WTO negotiation, today we are seeing ministerials are happening for the sake of ministerial. But what the breakthrough are coming from at least last 3 or 4 ministerials? So nothing is coming up. Do you think there's a global consensus is growing against globalization?
I don't think a global consensus is growing. However, I do think that there is some kind of a separation here between two parts of the world. And so the more advanced economies, those economies that have had the good fortune to have been developed for a long time, and so we call them more advanced for that reason, they, as I mentioned before, the quite often the middle class in those countries don't feel the benefits. They don't feel like their lives are getting better. And this is a very different sentiment from the sentiment, I think, in much of Asia, where in my experience from spending a lot of my life in Asia and being Australian as well, I think many people in Asia feel like their lives are better today than they were 50 years ago, and that in another 50 years, people's optimism is that things will be better again. Whereas I think in Europe and I think in America, the sentiment is the opposite. I think there's a fear that they're going backwards, and not so much that they're going to decline, because I don't believe Europe and America are going to decline. I think they are very successful economies and societies generally, but obviously have problems like everywhere has problems. But there is an overwhelming sentiment that's negative about globalization in those so-called advanced economies. And the other thing about these economies of the Atlantic, of the global north, the thing about these economies is that they have had such power in the international system for hundreds of years. So they're used to ruling the world in an earlier era of colonialism. And so for hundreds of years, those countries, and in particular the big ones, have been used to setting the narrative. They've been used to their stories becoming the dominant stories of the world. And so that's a big adjustment to make, I think, because the narrative in the West of, you know, is populist sentiment against globalization is something that will have a lot of influence in the world. Whereas the sentiment of more optimism in Asia is not going to penetrate into North America and Europe as much because of the difference in those narratives. And there's a structural competition underway as well because of that that point that I made, that is a controversial point, but you know, the point that these advanced economies have benefited from the structure of the international system for so long, and that's changing. So the rise of China and India, and in the future Bangladesh and Indonesia and Vietnam and many other developing countries to a much higher developed level will give more economic and political power to those countries. And so in the international system, we'll see more of a balance between the countries of the world based on population as much as their wealth. And that's a huge adjustment for the wealthy Western countries to make. That's not an adjustment they're really looking forward to. It is often seen as a threat. As an Australian, I see it as an opportunity that we need to figure out a way that we can all share power in a more equitable way, that is, that reassures us all, that is still a peaceful and prosperous future and doesn't have to be threatening. But I would say that I think within the West, people feel threatened by the structural shift that's underway, in particular the rise of China. And I think the other one more point here that's very relevant here in Europe, where I'm sitting at the moment, is this war against Ukraine being prosecuted by Russia is equally feeding into that fear. And so the fear in the West that authoritarian powers may want to disrupt the world order, this is a very deeply held fear. And unfortunately, Russia is giving evidence to that fear. And so when you have a fear and then you see evidence of it, that can evoke quite a response. And so I think all of this means that we're in a very dangerous time where it's quite possible that Western populations will be driven by fear. And anyone driven by fear often makes miscalculations and errors.
Yes, perfect, sir. Anyone driven by fear will lead towards miscalculation. Yes, global powerhouse is shifting. Global monopoly is becoming balanced again. So in this context, do you think there are some extra role to play by the big brothers, the big bosses, the Western big power, as well as China, the emerging power, Russia, or you have mentioned about China, India, Brazil, South Africa. So these types of countries, those who are really coming, emerging as global players. So do you think they have something extra to play for making globalization more effective and to ensure the global interdependence, global cooperation among each other?
I do. I think that actually the powers that are rising and what we might describe as the middle powers as well, those countries, even including my own home country of Australia, which is a small population, but it's a continent, and in energy and resources terms, it's very significant in the international economy. So countries that are middle powers but are lodged within the West, like Australia or like European countries, or emerging developing countries, certainly I think can play a role here in reimagining what international cooperation can look like. Because if we remain trapped in this belief that the international system must be ruled by one country, as it has been for the last few decades since the end of the Cold War, or if we fall back into the trap of believing that the world must be a struggle between two powers, as it was in the Cold War, then I think we're missing a huge opportunity, because actually, if it does become a big competition between China and the US alone, it's actually missing out most of the world. You know, most of the world is made up of the rest of us. And so it's actually in the interests of the rest of us to find a way to reassure both China and the US that, you know, we can design a system that appeals to them and that meets their needs and their interests, but also protects all of ours as well. And this is where the rise of China is it is a risk, of course, because maybe China will want to have more power than the rest of the world will want it to have. But equally, it's an opportunity in that maybe if we work with China, we can figure out a way to actually absorb China into the international system without a huge disruption to the international system. Now, every rising power in the past has created some form of disruption. And so, you know, we must expect this will be a rocky, difficult time, but I don't think it will be China alone that will be rising. I think clearly India as well is extremely important, and you've mentioned some of the other countries as well. So this is a question of, do we see the world in a very simplistic sense? Is it a chessboard and are there only two pieces on the chessboard? Or is it actually 200 countries, all of which have a voice and many of which have quite a bit of power in the system as well and imagination to manage this transition and this period? China is making some interesting contributions. You know, it's come up with this Belt and Road Initiative idea. It's created some new institutions for finance, and it's become very active in international peacekeeping. And so from China's perspective, they would say that they are making some